A Group 8 production. In association with YSU Nursing. Advance directives.
Scenario. A family discusses advance directives with their 86-year-old mother admitted to a long-term care facility.
Good morning, Mrs. Jones. My name's Sarah. I'm going to be your nurse here today. How are you feeling?
I'm a little tired. Didn't get much sleep last night.
That's understandable. It can be hard to sleep while you're in the hospital. But I'm just here to get some vital signs on you right now and do a quick assessment. Are you having any pain today?
I'm feeling a little nauseated, but it's nothing new.
Is there any medicine you can give her for that? I know she's been asking for a couple of days now.
Yeah, I could check to see if you have any Zofran ordered. I know with your diagnosis of glioblastoma that the doctor talked about yesterday, nausea is pretty common with that diagnosis. How are you feeling about that diagnosis?
It comes as a bit of a shock for sure.
But don't you worry, Mother. We're going to do everything in our power to get you better. I've been researching these really awesome clinical trials at the Cleveland Clinic, and I'm pretty sure I can get you in. So no time, we're going to get you back on your feet. I'm going to go to the cafeteria to get a bite to eat. I'll be right back.
That's my son, James. He worries too much about me.
So I know this is a lot of new information at once for you.
Yeah, it is, but I've lived a good life. I've traveled, had a career, had kids, grandkids, and I just don't know if I want to spend what time I have left in the hospital.
Well, you do have options. If you'd like, I can set up an appointment with our social worker for you and your son to discuss the further options. Is that something you'd be interested in?
Yeah, that'd be great.
All right, perfect. Let me go make the call right now.
Thanks so much.
What are advance directives? Advance directives are legal documents that allow you to spell out your decisions about end-of-life care ahead of time. They give you a way to tell your wishes to family, friends, and healthcare professionals, and to avoid confusion later on if something were to happen to you. There are two main elements in an advance directive: a living will and a durable power of attorney for healthcare.
Hi, Mrs. Jones. My name's Erica. I'm a social worker here at the hospital. It's very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
James.
How are you doing today?
Good. How are you?
I'm okay. So before we get started, I want you to know that we have a lot of information to cover today. If at any point you have a question or you feel overwhelmed and need a break, please just let us know.
We will do that. Thanks.
No problem. So I understand that before coming to the hospital, you were living at home alone. Given your current health situation, I do not believe that it's safe for you to return home alone unless you have someone there to care for you.
Well, obviously I would love to take care of my mother at home, but I work full time and also have three kids at home. I do have a younger sister, but she lives in California, so that's not an option.
I see. Well, we do have some really wonderful long-term care facilities here in the area. If you'd like, when we're finished here, I can go grab some brochures for you to look through.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Great. Now, we need to discuss your advance directives. This is a legal document that will only go into effect should you not be able to make decisions or speak for yourself.
That sounds scary.
I know. I know it's tough to think about, but this will ensure that your son, your doctors, and everybody else taking care of you will know exactly what you want and will follow only what you want. So part of this is establishing your healthcare power of attorney. This is a person who you will legally appoint someone to make medical decisions for you should you not be able to do so yourself. Is there anybody that you could think of you would like to appoint?
Well, it used to be my husband before he passed away. But I know if James would like to, I would like him to be mine because he's someone I trust.
I can definitely do that.
Okay, perfect. Now, if you'd like, you can set up a living will.
What's that?
The living will lets your doctors know what life-saving interventions and treatments you would like to have done in case the situation ever arose. It can also include your DNR status as well.
Well, shouldn't you guys be doing everything in your power to prevent that? It is kind of your job.
Well, as the patients, Mrs. Jones, you do have a say in what you would like. If you want, we can review the DNR options with you.
Yes, I would like that.
Living will and POA. A living will is a written document that helps you tell doctors how you want to be treated if you are dying or permanently unconscious and cannot make your own decisions about emergency treatment. In a living will, you can say which procedures you would or would not want and under which specific conditions. A A durable power of attorney for healthcare is a legal document naming a healthcare proxy, someone to make medical decisions for you at times when you are unable to do so. Your proxy, also known as a representative or agent, should be familiar with your values and wishes. This person will be deciding as you would when treatment decisions need to be made. A proxy can be chosen in addition to or instead of a living will. Having a healthcare proxy helps you plan for the unforeseen situations, like a serious car accident. It is important to be specific in either your living will and or your POA, because there are many different healthcare situations that you may have opinions on. For example, blood transfusions, dialysis treatments, artificial nutrition, CPR, or ventilator use. Spelling out your wishes makes it clear what you do and do not want done. Code statuses. Full code status indicates that you want every available life-saving treatment if something were to happen to you. DNR, or do not resuscitate, tells medical staff that you do not want CPR or other life-saving measures taken. There are different forms of DNR statuses that one can choose for themselves. For instance, DNR CC or DNR comfort care means that you do not want any life-saving treatments such as CPR, ventilators, cardiac monitoring, or defibrillation. Care is focused on comforting the patient and having a peaceful death if something were to happen to this patient. DNR CCA comfort care arrest does not activate until you experience respiratory or cardiac arrest. You will get all medical care needed to keep you alive in the event of illness or injury. If you experience respiratory or cardiac arrest during treatment, then the DNR protocol is initiated and all resuscitation measures are stopped.
So, Mrs. Jones, what are you thinking?
I was thinking about doing a DNR CC. I would like medication to keep me comfortable, but I don't want to be intubated or have any CPR on me.
Would you want to receive artificial nutrition through tube feeding if needed?
No, thank you.
And you don't want to be on a mechanical ventilator, correct?
Correct.
Mother, are you absolutely sure you want that decision? I think you need more time to think it over.
Yes, son, I know, but when your father passed away, he had all that medical stuff done, all those tubes, all those wires, and I just don't want to go through that. You and your sister have been a big part of my life, and I know when it's time to go, I'll be ready.
I understand that, Mother. I love you dearly.
Love you too.
Okay, Mrs. Jones, we've covered a lot of ground today. We're going to go and give you guys some time to yourself. But before I do you have any questions for me?
So I have a durable power of attorney and a living will?
That is correct. Given your diagnosis, your doctor may want to have a follow-up meeting with you to discuss creating a POLST. That's a physician's orders for life-sustaining treatment. This will provide more specific and more personalized details and orders on what you would like to have done if the situation comes.
POLST or MOLST, physician order for life-saving treatment, or medical orders for life-saving treatment, are used when you are near the end of life or critically ill and know the specific decisions that may need to be made in terms of your treatment plan. These forms serve as a medical order in addition to your advanced directives. They make it possible for you to provide guidance that healthcare professionals can act on immediately in an emergency. Once these forms are signed, they are considered doctor's orders. The provider fills out the form after discussing the wishes with you or the family. The use of these forms varies state to state, so it's important to know your state's forms.
At any point, if I want to change anything, I can do that, right?
As long as you are still of sound mind and can communicate that, absolutely.
Good, good. Thank you guys so much. You've been so wonderful to me.
Our pleasure, Mrs. Jones. I'll be in touch with you soon about what's next.